So I'm really excited that Edward's here. We've actually, you know, I've been working on Ember since the beginning, and Edward has been lurking in the shadows since the beginning, I think, of Ember. I'll let him speak a little bit more to that, but we were super excited when we finally tricked Edward into becoming a member of the core team after he wrote what you're going to see, Liquid Fire, which is basically the best way of animating in your Ember application, especially at the transition level. And so without further ado, I introduce Edward Faulkner, our MIT-educated Emacs-using Ember core team member.
Thank you. I'm not the only Emacs user in the room, right? All right. I got some hands. All right. So I actually wanted to segue quickly from the previous talk, which was an excellent summary of where testing is in Ember today, and just give you guys a quick preview of some newer ways we're hoping you can test components. And I actually I pulled this code up because Liquid Fire itself is using this new style of test, which is kind of hacked in directly into my own repo. You could check it out if you want. I have PRs where we're working on baking this directly into the Ember testing helper so that any app can do this. Integration tests have been a kind of a weak spot, in my opinion, in where the Ember's testing capabilities. The acceptance tests are great, where you boot the whole application and you work through it like a user. The unit tests are great, where if you truly have a unit that's truly isolated and you want to do algorithmic complexity, you do module 4 or whatever. But in the case of particularly components, and Ember 2.0 is a very component-centric world that we're trying to move towards where everything's a component all the time, how you test components is so critical to your application. And that was an area where we've been iterating on trying to come up with better APIs for testing components. And so I think that every component the basic test for a component is always an integration test, because most of what your component is doing is integrating with a whole bunch of other systems, the DOM, HTML bars, all the built-in helpers that it's calling, any other helpers or components that it's calling. And so this is an example of a newer way to write tests. And I'm hoping we've got some discussions in PRs where we think this will be the new default implementation for module 4 component, because it's the best way to test components. It's just driven directly from a template. So here's an example of a template-driven test for a component. And so if you've written component tests in the past, you tend to end up with a long and growing list of needs, all the other modules that you interact with, which is really the tell that you're not writing a unit test. You're testing a degree of integration between those things. So we're trying to come up with ways to make that easier. And in this case, I think the test reads pretty well, straightforward. You can see what it's doing. We're literally just providing a snippet of template that we're going to actually render and then be able to interact with. Right? So fairly self-explanatory when you read a test like this. We have this set and this get to actually just set properties directly in the context of where this template's going to render. We can handle actions and things. I don't know if I have any of those in this test. But I wanted to just give this as a preview, as a follow-on from Mike's talk of the current way we're testing to a way that we're hoping to make it easier. Really, the public API that components give you is all access through templates, right? You wouldn't normally instantiate one by calling new or create. You would just put in a template. So we're trying to find ways to make tests just that easy as well. And one of the kind of things that are easy to test using this new way that's not easy to test today in the existing ways is things like when your component wants to receive a block, a block of template, or yield values out to another component. All that stuff is fairly esoteric today, and this is an example of how we can make it less esoteric. So I wanted to give you that as a little preview of testing as a segue from our last thing. So I'm going to do a demo here with some live coding. And I have a demo application that I made in honor of our hosts, LinkedIn. And some of the LinkedIn folks saw me do this already earlier today, and I'm going to be that much better this time because of my second try. But this here is I've cloned in an Ember CLI app a small piece of LinkedIn's app. Right, this is the people you may know list. I have my suggestions. I can click on a person, and I could bring up their profile. And so this is real data. And it's actually coming live off of my real account at LinkedIn. And I'm using Ember CLI to do that. So that's something I wanted to show quick, because it's a cool feature of Ember CLI that I don't think everybody knows. So let's show how this works. So my app is your basic app. that Ember CLI generated. And I've got routes. I've got two of them here. Contact suggestions and the profile. And if we look at how those routes are implemented, here's my contact suggestions route. It's very straightforward. We have this service called the LinkedIn API, and we're loading the contact suggestions. So I'm able to hide all the complexity of how I actually get that stuff behind a service. And the reason I'm using a service is because it's actually stateful. It's going to cache things that it's already requested and know about them. Here's what the service itself looks like. So a service, for those who haven't used one, is really simple. There's not much to the API. It's really just if you have some object that you want to be long-lived in your Ember application, it's got to have some state. Service is the way to go. And this is going to be especially important in Ember 2.0 when singleton controllers that we have today are getting deprecated and we're moving away from those. Singleton controllers have a bunch of difficulties and problems with them. And services are a nice, much more elegant way to get one of the things that you currently would have done with a controller, which is to have some long-lived state in your application that needs to span across components, across routes. And so it's really just Ember service itself, the class, has basically nothing in it. It's really just an Ember object. But you can use any arbitrary Ember object here. For kind of future upgrade possibilities, you should derive from Ember service so that you are fully compliant. But my contact suggestions is just making an AJAX call and parsing out of it one particular entry from the actual. This is an actual LinkedIn API that I reverse engineered. I don't work at LinkedIn. I don't have any inside knowledge. This was me cloning their app first from the outside. So there's this AJAX call to, you know, my namespace / contact suggestions. So where does that go?
Right. Did that leak out today in the stock market?
Yes. It was my fault that LinkedIn's stock went down 25% aftermarket. Wall Street saw me walking in the building and they knew it was over. Yes, thank you, Seth. So we could see that API actually. Here it is being served out of Ember CLI. It's just, boom, here's all this JSON. And the way that works is it's a built-in feature that Ember CLI has to generate a proxy. So you run Ember generate HTTP proxy, and it generates for you this directory called server, and it'll put it in an index file that's basically just some boilerplate that's going to set up for you an express middleware that's going to be able to handle requests coming in and let you stick stuff in. And all it's going to do here, you can actually see right on this one screen, this is the whole thing. It's going to look for files in mocks or proxies, and it's going to load them in to this server that is now available. Morgan is a logging library. All of this just comes directly straight. This is stock that comes out of the blueprint. You don't have to write this code. When you just run Ember generate HTTP mock or HTTP proxy, you get this stuff. So the proxies, I have two of them. Here's the contact suggestions proxy. I guess it does almost fit all on one screen. Most of this is boilerplate that gets generated for you. I'm just kind of giving it as a quick tour. You don't have to like read all the code and memorize it. I just want to familiarize people with what's available here because it's very powerful, especially if you find yourself in the position of trying to build a new wonderful Ember app on top of older infrastructure or other APIs that already existed, or even somebody else's APIs that they don't know you're using. So in this case, I can handle a GET request for contact suggestions. I'm going to do it by proxying through to LinkedIn. I'm actually proxying forward over HTTPS. It's actually checking the certs. And the way I'm able to do that is this function runs when a request comes in and I get a chance to do some rewriting on it. These are all the default things I just grabbed off a request that go there. I don't actually know if it needs them all, but that's what was there, so I just kind of copied them. All of them can be overridden in my own request if I want to, say, request a different page with a different offset, all works. And here's where I actually set the path of the real request on LinkedIn.com. I stick my query params on the end. And here, critically, I'm setting a cookie header out of a file that I have here on disk where I have a cookie, my cookies and my CRSF token that I've grabbed out of Chrome DevTools. And so Ember CLI is taking care of, for me, the authorization to LinkedIn. And so that's why when I actually hit this endpoint, it's actually proxying through to the real LinkedIn. So kind of a neat trick when you're building out an application and testing, even if you have a legit API ready to go, very convenient to have Ember CLI doing all the proxying for you and worrying about things like cookies and auth and domain and cross-domain concerns. For the second route, it's very similar, except for this one, there was no, at least publicly visible, JSON API for this data. And so I'm using the patented technique that Ibrahim pioneered called Ember Turbo Links. I'm actually not using his extension. I just copied his code because I only need a little bit of it. But the basic idea is that, again, I have a proxy just like the one you saw, except this one is fetching an HTTP page, passing it back through to me. And then in the browser, I'm actually parsing it and pulling out just the selectors that I want and basically rendering them directly in. So if we go and look at, let's take a look at how this application is laid out. So in our templates, I have a top-level template that just has these three things, my main outlet and my header and my footer. The header and footer are fairly boring. I literally just kind of grabbed everything that comes off of LinkedIn.com and dumped it in here. Same goes for the header. We don't need to see it. That's what's giving us everything in the top bar, everything in the footer. And then we have our outlet for our stuff that's going to change. Our suggestions page here is has its own template, contact suggestions. It looks like this. We have a wrapper component here called Peeper Wrapper. That's where I stashed all the cruft, the like 10 layers of divs and HTML coming off of this site, so that we'd be able to look at this and actually understand what's going on here. And then we are going to actually iterate over our data and put in a component for each one called Person Card. So here's Person Card. I grabbed this layout right off the website and then just reverse engineered where the curlies need to go to fill in the data. And so it's mostly just, again, a dump of stuff, except now we've got some curlies. So like, here's an example where this is the person's image, and I actually have an inline if here, where if this person has a picture URL, we'll use it, and otherwise we'll use the default one that coming off directly off the CDN. So this is all intended to be kind of showing that the application itself looks like a very straightforward Ember CLI app. It's the kind of thing you could write very easily. And I'm very easily able to adapt existing styles, designs, data, all into the application to begin iterating on designs right away. So, and for completeness, I'll show you the other one, which is the profile page, which has a super simple template. We're using a triple curly, which means that this is unescaped. Trust this content. It's got its own layout for it. And this is basically the Ember Turbo Link style, which if you use the add-on will actually do this view for you. But in this case, my model, it just has one property called HTML, and it's a big blob of HTML, and I dump it in. All right, I'm not doing anything to it. Actually, that's slightly a lie. I'm actually adding in a couple of strategic places a couple of HTML attributes that we're going to see in a bit, just to make our animations easier. All right, so now that we have this thing, this abomination. Actually, there's one more thing I'm going to do first, which is rather than put myself at the vagaries of the network and see what data it's going to give me, right now we're looking at live data using all these proxies. I'm going to switch it over to Mox. So this was my API service I had before. I showed you I have these API endpoints that are proxying through, but I also have Mox endpoints. And all they really do, this is again something built into Ember CLI, you can say Ember generate HTTP mock, and it'll give you the boilerplate to just basically lay out, if somebody asks for this URL, give them this. If they try to post to it, do this. And so the mocks are really just recorded versions of the stuff I was just showing. Right? So just by switching that, already my app has reloaded. Ember CLI knew to restart the server with the new middleware, the page reloaded. This is my mocked data now that was an earlier recorded version of the stuff I got off the site. And now it loaded almost instantly because I've got all this stuff available locally already. So the mocks are being served over HTTP from Ember CLI to the browser app. So from the browser app's perspective, the only thing that has changed is the URLs that I'm hitting for my API. I added this prefix to them. So now let's talk about how we could start to take an app like this, if it was an existing Ember CLI app, and add some rich motion design behavior. So first, I guess I'll give the high level on what the goal is here, because animation is one of those powers you can use for good or evil. You need to think about design and motion design and design in general as something as a developer whose title is not designer. And do I have any designers in the room? All right, we've got at least one. But it's a pretty skewed audience. So most people are in my shoes, which is I'm a developer first, and I've had to learn a lot of design over time, and I've worked hard at becoming marginally competent at it. And it's always awesome when you have somebody who's actually a designer by trade and can help you with this stuff. But I do always encourage developers to put in the work to become fluent in the language so that you can at least work productively with designers at a much higher level than just kind of punting and saying, I wasn't born with that gene. I don't do design. I think every developer is always doing design of user experiences. Sometimes even when the user that you're developing for is another developer who's going to have to interact with your code in the future, with your APIs in the future, it's really all the same core set of skill, even if it doesn't look like it on the surface. Right? It all comes down to how well can you model somebody else's brain when they're going to look at your stuff. What are they going to think about it? Can you put yourself into their shoes and see it from their perspective? And that changes the way you design something, whether that's the way you write code, the way you design a framework, the way you design an API, or the way you design an end user application. So that's my pitch for design. We think carefully about it. Animation and motion design in specifically has to be motivated by the question, how am I helping the user to understand the state of the system? One of the most frustrating things about design of all kinds, whether that's software or everyday devices that we interact with, is systems where the state is ambiguous, right? You don't know if the action you tried to take is doing anything. You can't see at a glance and understand what state the system's already in. Right? And those kind of systems frustrate anybody who uses them, and that's just bad user experience. So one of the awesome tools we have once we have motion design is to convey much more clearly to users the effect their actions are having on the system. So we can tap into all this experience we have as human beings who have this amazing visual system evolved over millions of years to perceive the physical world and the way it behaves. And all of a sudden, we drop users into this very abstract world of software where objects instantly appear and instantly disappear, and they don't come or go from anywhere. They're just there. And there's no real space. It's all metaphors. All of that is very hard for people to intuitively grok. And us as developers train for years and years to be so good at abstraction that we can actually live in this world, because we have to. But the people who use your software, and even other developers, because all of us, it has a cognitive load to deal with that level of abstraction. When we could take some of that off and actually take advantage of the things our brains are good at, everything flows so much more smoothly. So motion in particular lets us make things act as if they're physical, right? So things don't have to appear and disappear instantly. They can come and go with the simulation of momentum, with the simulation of bouncing off of each other, physicality, all those kinds of things. So I'll just in passing recommend read Google's material design document, which is a kind of wonderful summary of some of these principles, the way they're being applied there. Even if you don't want your stuff to look like their stuff, they've done a nice job of summarizing the principles that you can apply always in general. So with that, let's add some motion to this so that when a user chooses one of these choices, they're going to actually get a real gut feel link for how they got from point A to point B. So liquid fire exists to solve a very precise problem, which is animation transition. Well, the specific kind of animation I'm talking about, right? I'm not talking about the kind of animated flash ads that you may have seen. Right? That's animation too. Or not a cartoon, which is a way to really convey awesome stuff, but again, it's not what I'm talking about. The kind of motion we're talking about here is helping the user see the state change in the system, which is almost always the result of what they did. Right? So if you're deciding to animate something based off of anything other than the user's own action, ask yourself real carefully if you should be doing that. Right? There are occasionally times, probably the only one would be like some really important update coming in from the outside world, and you need to like bring their attention to something. Think about the way OS X bounces an icon on the dock. Right? That's an excellent example of that kind of pattern. As an aside, I don't know, some people can sit and watch and let their icon bounce on the dock and not pay attention to it. And I sit next to them and I'm like, you know there's an application that wants your attention, right? You really need to click that. I can't sit here next to you and not acknowledge that. But my wife in particular can do that. And we're all different, you know. So, oh, I know, she's probably watching me on the live stream. That may be one of the times when you can animate for something that's not initiated by the user. But in general, it's the user initiating an action, and you're going to animate to show them how they change the state of the system. So in Ember, that has a fairly precise meaning because where does that animation live, right? It's not a property necessarily of one component, of one template, of one controller, of one route. It lives in the gaps between those things. Right? You have an initial state and a final state, and the user changed the system from one to the other, and the animation lives in the interstices, right, between. And so it doesn't have a place in the traditional hierarchy of the things that make up an Ember application, which is why I designed the library the way I did, where our animations are something we define separately from all these other things. We make the smallest possible little additions to our templates, and then outside of that, we have declarative rules for describing how states change. So let's be concrete about that, and I'll give some examples. So here again is my top-level application template. It just has an outlet. Now I'm going to switch to the Liquid outlet, which is one of the helpers provided by the library. And it is conceptually a drop-in replacement for the outlet we have in No. And so the page is the same right now. There is one gotcha here, which I'm going to mention because it gets enough people, which is that I have added some markup when I did that. You may know that the usual Ember outlet has no markup of its own. It's a placeholder for whatever you're going to put in it. But in this case, I've actually added two layers of markup. So this body is the actual stuff inside the outlet. And these two layers, the liquid container and the liquid child, are both added as part of liquid outlet. So this is the first gotcha to be aware of, which is if your layout is very particular about direct descendant selectors or things like that, you are going to have to slightly adapt your CSS just to make sure, just to accommodate this new markup. In the earliest versions of LiquidFire, there was no extra markup deliberately to try to make it avoid this problem. And that brings on a whole host of other problems, which is it's a lot of complexity to manage the transition between I have my normal stuff in the normal document flow, it's just statically positioned, it is where it is, and then all of a sudden I want to animate it. And now I have to do a whole bunch of DOM manipulation magic in CSS to figure out how to swap all those things to being absolutely positioned, but still appear to be in the same exact place, and maybe even move their parents around. And that turned out to be hard enough that it was worth it baking that into the library. And so that's why this markup is here. There's actually two layers of important stuff it's doing for you, which is why this markup is here. I'll give some more precise examples of those as we go on, but I wanted to be aware that that's the one thing we changed when we made this, when we dropped this this Liquid Outlet in. And the same goes for the other helpers. So Liquid Outlet is a drop-in replacement for Outlet. Liquid If is a replacement for If, etc. They have the intended semantics of the Ember helpers they replace, except that they all share this one trick, which is when the state they're consuming, whether that is the outlet that is the view that's being rendered into this outlet, or if it's a liquid if, the thing it's consuming is the predicate that it's testing. Right? When that changes, they're going to basically hold on to the old value and the new value, have access to both, and then delegate to the library to say, should I do something with these values? I actually have both of them. Let's do an animation if we need to that can actually interact with multiple states at once. So the place we do that is we make a transitions map. So app transitions.js is the convention. This is intended to be analogous to your router map. And it has a similar kind of idea, which is it's a high-level place to summarize the rules that govern how this application is put together. So we're going to add a transition rule. And so each instance of this transition is a rule. And the rule is composed of any number of constraints and an action. And so the system is going to, when something like a liquid outlet sees its value change, it's going to consult the transition map and say, does my situation match any of these constraints? If so, I'm going to use the action in that rule to animate this thing. So in our case, I'm going to use route constraints from contact suggestions to profile. And I'm going to reference the name of an animation. And so fade is one of the ones that's built into the library. So now when I go across, I have that nice fade effect. Right. You'll notice it only works in one direction. When I go back, it's not there. That's because of the way my rule is written. You can see the constraints are actually written so that if it's from contact suggestions to profile, I will fade. Right. So conceptually now, let me show you first in longhand, and then I'll show you the short form. Right. Conceptually, we need to do a similar thing to go the other direction. And let's say we want to also fade there. So now we will have it in both directions. And that's such a common pattern, of course, that there's a shorthand for that where you could say reverse. And it will basically synthesize the second rule for you. And it's synthesizing it by swapping every instance of from to to. So this is going to do the same exact thing. And these particular constraints are based on routes. When you look through the docs, you'll see there's a lot of other things you can constrain on. You can constrain based on which helper it was. You could say in helper liquid outlet versus in helper liquid if. You could say based on the models that you're transitioning between, based on the values that are being passed to a liquid if or a liquid with or liquid bind. So there's fairly rich rules in here that are intended to be able to select all the stuff that that is sane to write rules around. And so the goal is that if there's stuff that you can't actually express in these rules, that it's you should double check whether it's a sane idea to be actually deciding to animate based on that constraint. And an example of that is I've sometimes been asked, how do I write a rule so that if people are pushing the back button, I get a certain animation versus when they're going forward? And that's actually not really a well-formed question, because the meaning of back really is just very arbitrary based on where they happen to enter your application. Right? These are Ember apps with real URL structures, and people could reload at any point or can deep enter your application. And so knowing what is forward and what is back is actually not as clear-cut a philosophical question as it seems on the surface. And remember, the whole goal is to help the user understand the application. One of the best ways we do that is to give a spatial layout so that, you know, route A and route B have the same spatial relationship all the time. The user begins to understand at a very gut level that my detail view is on the left, my list view is on the left, my detail view is on the right. Right? That's a convention that they've seen enough times now. And when they see it in your application, it's very natural. They know that I want to go back to that other view, and so the button to get me back there is on the left side of the screen. It's all very natural. And if you suddenly swap those things on them just based on random context, like which URL did you happen to hit first, that's very confusing. So this is kind of an example of Ember's philosophy in general, which is making it really easy to do the right things. And then when you start to go off the rails and do things that would throw you off the conventions, hurt the user experience, hurt the developer experience, all of a sudden you start to feel the resistance of the framework. Right? So that's part of just being an opinionated software in the first place. So anyway, this was a fairly simple example. We can do some other of the built-in ones just to show them off for people who haven't seen. Here's an example of to left, to right, reverse. Now they go back and forth. Let's show that you can add parameters to these. I'm going to just have a duration variable here, and I'm going to use it to pass to these guys. Yes, you can do that in ES6, right? We'll slow that down a little so that we can see it a little better. In general, you want to keep your speeds fairly higher than you think they should be. I've heard a good rule of thumb, which is like develop your application, and then before you ship, like shave 20% off of all the delays, because it should just you want to err on the side of being fast. It's easy when you spend all day tuning the motion design to overemphasize how awesome your motion design is. And as a user, it's just much better when it's that extra bit of snappy. So like this 500 milliseconds thing is probably great for a demo. I would go faster with a production thing. Next thing we want to do is, I accidentally showed a little bit of it, which is just scrolling is an issue. Scrolling is always a little bit of an issue in a single page app, because sometimes you have to be aware of scroll state. Whereas in a more traditional web application where the whole browser's re-rendering the whole page every time. The browser takes care of that. If somebody hits back, it's going to remember what scroll state they were in for you. In an Ember application, sometimes that'll be on you. And there's a bunch of good strategies for it. You can have components that are going to preserve scroll state. You can have your routes decide that they're just always going to scroll up to the top. And so in this example, that's actually what I have. So my profile route actually just always animates to the top. In fact, if I didn't have any animation at all, so like if I make this not match, I'll go back to non-animated, and you'll just see that when I go over, I just always scroll up to the top, which is a reasonable experience. You know, you could hone this further if you wanted to. Chrome actually is a little annoying here. It has some issues. It does its own, when you use the back button to transition between Ember routes, it does do its own state preservation, even if you wanted to do your own. So anyway, I wanted to just mention scrolling because it interacts with all these other motions, right? So the place where I'm doing that in this app is in the profile route. I just have an activate that animates to the top of the screen. And that's what you see here. So let's do something a little richer. I've been glossing over so far what these two left, two right, fade, all these things are. These are animations in the convention of Liquid Fire. You can write your own and put them into app transitions in their own files. The ones I'm using are built into the library, so if we actually look at the Liquid Fire source, they're under app transitions, and there's a bunch of them there. Here they are, the built-in ones. You've seen fade. And to left and to right, and you know all of these just simple slide ones, they're basically built on a single one under the hood that called move over that takes arbitrary arguments to move in arbitrary directions. So I highlight this as a way just to say when you're ready to dive in and understand a little more, or if you want to begin writing your own, the goal is that these APIs at this level, you don't need to go into this level just to get started. You can use the built-in ones. They cover an awful lot of cases. But my hope is to begin to build up an ecosystem of richer transitions. We want to have a nice API at this level as well, so that when you want to go down to the next level, it should be fairly easy to implement these things. So here's an example of a fairly simple one, just to give you a flavor of how they're implemented. And if you've looked at Liquid Fire more than, like, say, a couple months ago, this used to be a little more complicated. We're slimming down the API, trying to simplify it in anticipation of locking it down at 1.0 in June. So I think you can take a look at it and see it's not too complicated. The animate and stop things are helpers here provided by the library. They give you some really nice defaults. They use velocity.js to handle the animation. That is not something you have to do. You can use anything you want to do the animation here. You have full control over these elements. You can use CSS3 transforms. You can use some animation library. Whatever you want to do to them, if you want to just set properties on them, go to town. They're yours until you resolve that promise and say, I'm done. So in this case, I'm using my stop helper to just say, if the old element is already moving, stop it. And let's, in parallel, animate the old thing to opacity 0. And animate the new thing to max opacity, which defaults to 1, from 0. This is a convention that's basically passed straight through to Velocity. And if you read Velocity.js's docs on how all this works, it's fairly straightforward. So the goal is that this is not intimidating. Right? You could come in here and understand how to write it. What Liquid Fire has done for you is the hard part of doing this in an Ember app, which is we've captured the old and new states in parallel, which normally don't exist in the DOM together. They are in the DOM together for you here. You have this old element and this new element to animate as you wish. Whether you do those in series, in parallel, is up to you. And actually, old element and new element are the most common case, but it's completely possible that while those two are doing something, the user changes the system yet again, and you get a third state in there. And so the API will actually support arbitrarily as many states in flux at once. You actually have this older array that is all the older states if you really get into it. And there are certainly situations where that comes up. I just had a great talk with Nathan back there today about a case where we think we might want to do that. So, and there's actually some examples in the library itself of particularly how transitions can react to being interrupted. You know, this one is fairly straightforward. The only thing it's doing is that if the old element was already animating in some way, it's stopping it what it was doing. That's a fairly abrupt kind of way to interact to a interruption. You can do much more rich things. And so there's examples in the library as well of like the fade transition. Crossfade here is done in parallel, right? The old thing is fading out and the new thing's fading in at the same time, whereas the built-in fade transition does them in series. The old thing fades away and the new thing fades in. I could show some demos of that in a sec. But the built-in fade transition actually has better interruption support. So if you're interested in those cases, you could take a look at that as an example. So let's talk about doing some cooler animation. Transitions, other transitions, .js. I have too many files named transitions open. Oh, I guess I closed it. Okay. So there's another built-in called Explode. And what Explode does is it lets you pull apart the old and new elements based on CSS selectors and then delegate to other transitions, the transitions we just saw. You could delegate to a to left, to a fade, et cetera. And so in this case, I have strategically added some HTML attributes to these images. I have a data person image that I've added to each photo and that has their user ID in it. And I did the same thing on this image. And this is one way to do it. You don't necessarily, you can write kind of more complicated selectors and avoid editing your DOM sometimes. But this is a very straightforward way to do it. And it's a low impact on the complexity of your layout and your template to simply add a property. But what it's going to let us do is write a match by statement. So this is an argument I'm passing to the explode transition. Explode knows how to do match by. And so I could say data user image. That was what I called it, right? Do-do-do-do-do. Data person image. So that's why I check. OK. And I'm going to delegate to a new transition we haven't seen yet called fly to, which is a particularly good one to use in this case. So what fly to is going to do is it's going to look at that new element and that old element, and it's going to make the old one fly to the position of the new one. So initially, we get a little bit of effect. You can see that it's flying. Again, my back animation hasn't changed. And we see we've got a little bit of the effect we want, except that it's flying underneath the layout that was already there. Now, I did that to show one of the pitfalls of these kind of animations, which is people often, you are often relying on CSS cascading to style these things. And in an animation context, that can be problematic because what Explode is doing is it's called Explode because it's really pulling apart your DOM and moving these things around. So it's actually going to give you a clone of that image that that's outside of what was its parent. It's going to be a direct descendant now of the liquid container I mentioned earlier. Why would we do such an obtrusive thing? Think about how hard it is otherwise to basically have your background layer and your foreground layer both animating independently if the foreground is still a child of the background. Right? You want to make sure that they are not influencing each other. And so exploding it out is a nice, elegant way to do that and not worry about things like the fact that the bottom layer may be experiencing a hardware-accelerated transform transition that would otherwise influence the parent. Or, for example, opacity changes, which you can't even, there's no way, basically, to not inherit your parent's opacity. So we pull it apart. And so you do lose some styling if you had cascaded it. And so usually it's not a big deal to adjust your styles. I have got some here. I'm going to uncomment the first one here to solve this problem, which is that I'm just going to say, in this case, when my image is a direct descendant of the liquid container, give it a higher z-index. So now when I go forward to here, it actually flies correctly. Let's slow it down a little so we can see it. Here you can see I changed the syntax here because use, I'm kind of overriding the word use here, right? Because there's a use here that's directly in the DSL, whereas the explode transition also takes options, and one of those is called use, which it uses to delegate to more transitions. And in this case, it can take a list if you want to have arguments. So there it is with the list. We can make it fly more slowly, and now it does the right thing. Right. So we have a little more continuity now between where we came from and where we're going. So next, let's actually clean up the reverse direction. I'm going to do something, use and reverse as a shorthand. So now it's going to apply the same rule in both directions, which in this case is OK. And we can go back, and it works. All right, very nice. So the next step we're going to use, so right now we're doing a single step, right? We're pulling one thing out and ignoring the rest. But explode can do an arbitrary number of steps, and you just pass them as separate arguments here. So you can also provide a default thing to do for all the other stuff that doesn't match, right? Which in this case is everything other than the picture. I'm going to use a fade. So now when I go across, everything else fades, right? That's my default. And so now we have a much more elegant transition. This one you'll notice didn't fly because some people who don't have an image on this view, there's no image to match. The matchers fail gracefully. If there's nothing to do, there's nothing to do. And they're just going to be OK with that. You'll see that I mentioned the scrolling capabilities before. Those are there for a reason, right? That lets you do this stuff. If you're down here, it's going to take you right up. All right, so let's make it better, though. So I want to also have a kind of card-like effect where the whole white box here is going to go to match this whole white box here. Okay, and so again, you know, keep in mind the reason that it selects the right person. You notice that my rule doesn't say anything about which one did I click on, right? It's doing a match purely based on attributes, where it's looking at the whole initial state. This one you're looking at right here, right? Everything that's not the title, you know, header bar, is all in play for this transition. It's the old state. We're going to search through it for things that have an attribute that match things that have an attribute on this state. So that's how it's finding, right? There's nothing about which one did I click. It's purely based on what is the old state, what is the new state. We're going to be able to do the same thing with the cards. I have given them as well an attribute. Let's make sure I got the name right again. And keep in mind, I stole all this layout, so I didn't write it. There you go, yeah. Member ID. I'm just trying to make sure that's the right one, because there's actually were originally ones in the thing, but that's it. Let's try that. And let's do the same exact thing with this one. Okay, so that didn't actually work. Is it? Yeah, thank you. Okay, so here we go. So this is what I wanted to get, to show the first step in making this actually like look nice. So we're definitely getting something here. You can see that the content is moving. You could see we're suffering the same style problem. These cards have very cascaded styles. So as soon as they come out of the document flow, they're losing their background. So if you focus on the forward transition from here to the profile, right, watch, it's going to lose its white background, and it's going to lose the style of all the text as it goes across. So let's fix that. So this is the style that was cascading before that I'm putting directly onto that div right now. So that in the forward direction here, I'm going to preserve my background. Now you can actually see the shape of the card as it moves, because it's keeping its background and its shadow. Okay. So the next thing I want to do is I'm going to write a rule where the content that was not in place is just not showing while we're moving. Remember, we're going to move this element up to be a direct descendant of the container while it's moving. So I could say, when you're a direct descendant of the container, hide your content. When you're a direct descendant of the container, hide your button. Right. And so that's a fairly straightforward way to get rid of the stuff that was in our way. And so we have it at least working in the forward direction here. The back one, we'll get to that next. So in the forward direction, we have a fairly nice transition now. Our content is just showing up when we get there. Looks pretty good. So to go back, we could do the same thing with the other style rules on the other side. But there's another option that I want to use just to highlight some of the other things you can do with the library. So One of the things we gloss over is this fly to, the way it works. You'll notice that it's always taking the old state and moving that to the new place. And then at the end of the transition, it's going to delete the old one, and the new one's finally going to be appearing there. So the thing that animates across the screen and actually moves is the old element. It doesn't have to be that way. We can actually tell it, I would like the new element to be the one to move across the screen. It's always still going to move from the position of the old one to the position of the new one, but it's actually up to us which element is it that actually does the flying. So we can change that and say moving side new. Instead of moving the old one, which is the default, we're going to move the new one. And so what we'll have done in this case is now our backward transition looks good, and now our forward one suffers the problem. Right? Because remember, we're using the same rule in both directions. So we've made it work good in one direction, but not the other. So now I'm going to just show how we can actually have different options for both directions. So one thing we had to do is, you'll remember we combined our forward and reverse rules into this one nice shorthand, and that's a nice thing to do. We could switch this back to use. We could copy it all and make a separate reverse rule and change the instruction. That would work just fine. But it's also fine to just add more entries here in our rule and have ones that are only going to match in one direction. And if they don't match, they won't harm anything. It's just going to move on and try to match the next thing. So I'm going to have different options for two directions. One is moving side new. The other is the default thing, which, you know, just for completeness, I'll write it in, moving side old. And we need to constrain these so that only the right thing is going to do it. So I can actually constrain down what kind of elements will I try to match by putting in a pick selector. I could say pick if I want it to apply to both sides. I could say pick old or pick new if I want to just filter down one side. So if I want to say on the old side, I only want to match, this thing was called card wrapper. Right. So pick the card wrapper on the old side for this rule. Pick the card wrapper on the new side for this rule. So now I think it will actually look good in both directions. And so the reason it looks good in both directions is because every time we go, we're always animating the small card, which we've written good CSS rules for, and not the big card, which we didn't. So we have a pretty good interaction there with not a lot of heartbreak and complexity, right? Our impact on the templates was very, very minimal, right? All we had was that one outlet to liquid outlet, and we had I added some data attributes, which I mentioned, which made it easier to do the selection. So that is really the goal and why LiquidFire exists. It's easy as a shorthand to call it an animation library, and I do that too, but really what it does is something a little bit more nuanced, which is it's really just setting you up and getting you in the right place to do an animation, decide which one to do, and then delegate off to whatever is going to actually push the bits around. So that's why it's fairly agnostic to what is doing the animating. The default built-in ones use velocity.js, but it doesn't have to be that. The real goal is organizing your application so that you can actually build in a really rich app that's being modified by a bunch of people over time, a growing team. You don't want to get to the point where all your concerns get tangled and you have a lot of extra complexity just to do animations. And so that really influences the architecture here of how this all works under the hood. Right? My earliest attempts at animating in Ember always ended up getting stuck cutting across concerns where routes would need to know about the fact that some of the views they were manipulating were animating. Right? You may have done this yourself if you've tried to hammer on the problem hard enough and you realize something like particularly getting content to animate off screen. It really feels like you want to be able to block the whole system and say, hey, wait, router, like, don't get rid of my old stuff yet. I want to animate it. That gets really messy because now you're cutting across. The routes need to understand it. The views need to understand it. The controllers need to know not to push new values down yet because you want the old ones still to be visible. And that way lies madness. And so my goal with LiquidFire was to put the smarts all in the view layer and let the router do its thing, let the data layer do its thing, and not know at all about the animation. And in the view layer itself, deal with these state changes. You know, you can have statefulness in your view layer where something that has rendered before is still there. If the router has moved on and it's already thinks you've transitioned to a wholly new state, Liquid Outlet or Liquid If or whatever can still be holding onto that old DOM and moving it around. And you will catch up with the logical state when on the view layer's own schedule. Right? That is the goal. And so it dovetails fairly nicely with all the Glimmer work and the move to a very clear data flow where data flows downward, actions flow upward. We've already refactored Ember's own outlet system to be completely data down, where in a fairly kind of functional way, reactive way almost, to use the buzzwords of the day. The router used to reach directly into, go and find an outlet, instantiate a view, and stick it in there. And that's problematic for a whole bunch of reasons, but it was definitely problematic for animation because sometimes you really just want the view layer to do its own thing. You don't want it messing with your views yet because you're going to animate the old one out, et cetera. And so now it's all very separated. All the router does is present to the view layer, here's this structure that represents the current routes that I think should be the current routes. And so I have a name of a template, I have a controller, I have, and it has children that are going to be these things. It's just this nested tree structure. And it's purely abstract, and the router changes it as it needs to. And then the view layer has the chance on its own schedule to react to that, right? And turn it into actual views. So that's conceptually the kind of model you're going to want to use for all your data in Ember 2.0, and you can already begin writing your apps that way today. So let's do a couple more little demos. I'm going to add another route just so we can show a couple of features we haven't used yet. Let's see. So we'll just call it Playground. And I actually have a template I put in already so that I'm ready to go. All it does is call the Playground component inside a suitable container. So let's create this component. So let's make sure it works. All right. So I wanted to just show quickly a couple other things we hadn't touched on yet. I have also a component here that has two very simple actions, edit title and save title, which just set this editing flag. So let's use this here, if editing title input value equals title, else title. All right, so this is, like Ember 101 should be straightforward. My component has a default title there. So we come in. I was going to also make this clickable. So the name of it is edit title. So let's do edit title. So now we should be able to click it, and it'll go to the editing version. And let's give ourselves a button here to save it. That'll take us back. Okay, so pretty straightforward. So now let's switch to the animated versions. So liquid if instead of if. Again, it's a drop-in replacement. It is adding some markup for us. And right away, even though we haven't written any transition rules, we have a behavior change, right? I mentioned the container doing stuff for you. This is what that's doing. It's going to nicely adapt us to the height of our content changing and move the rest of the flow for us. And that container is, in normal, like when it's not animating, is not absolutely positioned or anything. It's not interrupting our document flow. We still get to write a nice statically positioned layout, which is easier. It lets you, it's going to just dynamically choose the right height for its content, et cetera, et cetera. But then when we go to animate, it has early warning. It knows things are about to change. It locks itself down, locks its own size, and says, okay, go ahead and animate. Put in the new thing, and it measures that, and then it decides how it's going to animate. So it's doing its own size animation from one state to the next. That's why the footer is going up and down. You do have control over that. All of these helpers have options to control those if you really want to. You can make it grow much more slowly. There's actually two parameters for tuning it, because grow pixels per second. Basically, because a lot of these, if they change in size only a little bit, it's often silly to use a fixed duration time period. Like if something's only getting 3 pixels higher, and you said, take 200 milliseconds to grow, it'll do this fairly kind of absurdly slow growth, right? So we actually have these two parameters where you can basically set minimums. So the default grow duration is it's going to take 250 milliseconds to grow, but it will never grow slower than 200 pixels. Grow pixels per second. Did I get that right? I did. So it should be possible to slow it down, is the point. I just made a bunch of changes here, so if it's not working, that's probably why. I say it to highlight the fact that you have control over these things, and you could disable the behavior entirely if that's what you want. So the next thing is just all of these helpers also, they take an optional use. If all you have is one very simple thing you want it to do, and you don't really need to pass arguments, and you don't care about the context, and you just always want it to do the same thing, it can do that without writing a transition rule separately. Next thing I want to show quick is that there's a lot of ways to write rules. We showed so far the only constraints we saw were these two, from route and to route. Conceptually, because we've only really had two routes up till now, I really only needed one of those because as long as all the constraints match, it will apply. And so if you only have two routes, just saying from route context suggestions to anything would have been sufficient, right, for our earlier case. I'm going to write a new one for our new liquid if, and I could just say in helper liquid if. This is another kind of constraint. This one will limit me this rule to only applying to liquid ifs. I could say something like to up, and now it's always going to go up. All right. So next thing we logically think we want to do is reverse with down. The problem here is that, let's see what happens, it still always goes up. Right. So this is where we have to be aware of our constraints having directionality or not. Right? In helper liquid if is simply always true. So that constraint always matches, and so our forward rule simply always matches. The reverse rule is the same thing, so it's actually just kind of a toss-up they both basically match. The ties are broken in rule order, and it just so happens that the forward rule comes before the reverse rule, so it wins. So what we need to do instead is constrain this so that our rule only matches in one direction. And so we can say something like from value or to value true, and to value true, it's not going to do a triple equals comparison. To value true is actually just any truthy to value. And so now it actually has a directionality to it, because when our if is going from false to true, the forward rule matches. When it's going the other direction, the reverse rule matches. Because again, reverse just switches every to a from, right? So it's conceptually would be if it would be from value true, right? Which would give us the opposite sense. And so now it's going to do the opposite thing. Right? So to route from route, to value from value gives you almost everything you need. There's a bunch of and in helper. There's also some class-based ones like has a parent selector matching your context in the DOM. The goal is that you should be able to write rules to match your scenario without having to do crazy other manipulations outside of this. Right? If you think you need to like set a class on your DOM before animating so that you can write a rule that'll see the class, like that's not so fine. Like work with me. We can find a way to make the rules do it. As a kind of wrapping up, I will just say I'll show just a little bit under the hood of what's going on here. Oh, let me show you one more thing that's very useful, though, before I do that. So you can add a debug statement here to the rule. And what that's going to do for us, let me make it tall so maybe we could see it a little better, is anytime one of the helpers is potentially going to animate, it's going to spew for that particular rule what it thinks about that transition. So here we see checking transition rules for this element, which is the one we want, the liquid if. Liquid fire rule tool, rejected because of constraint on old value was undefined. liquid fire rule two reverse matched. Right, so that was our rule matching. And we'll get the opposite result if we do the other thing. And so this really exists to solve one of the more frustrating things, which is if the rules don't match, it's not obvious why. Now it should be obvious why. And you know, all the constraints are additive, so you know, you can have more than one from value, for example, and they all have to work. They can be fairly arbitrary. You could say something like, you know, whatever you really want it to be, right? It could be an arbitrary function. It could be regex, etc. So a lot of flexibility there, intended to be comprehensive. And so all of this is motivated by the architecture, which is, you know, have one kind of decide where the top point is that's going to manage this transition, whether that's your liquid outlet, your liquid if, and then declaratively give it rules that let it kind of sit and command the whole state change, no matter what state changes it sees. That plays really well with the performance of the system, with the ease of thinking about the system. The alternative would be that every child element all the way down the tree would have to have a veto over whether we're ready to tear down the view yet, because if you baked these states directly into one of your templates, the one that's coming or going, you know, all of a sudden you get this explosion in complexity. So I will wrap up by showing very briefly, for those who might want to dig in deeper, that none of this is actually black magic inside. So liquid fire has these components in it. And the ones that we've talked about, like liquid if here, are all implemented on the same handful of primitives. Let me show its template. So it's not going to fit super nice on the screen. So that the first layer, there's just an if containerless versus not. There's two versions of this. And so containerless lets you strip that container layer off that I mentioned, which is if you really want to manage all the layout yourself, you're going to deal with positioning in containers and absolute positioning. You can do that. I'm going to take that out just to show more clearly what's happening here. So at the outermost level, we have a liquid container. And it takes a whole bunch of properties, which is why it looks long. All of these are really kind of optional things. And so conceptually, we really just care about this part. So liquid container as container, this is an example of one way that two tightly coupled components can coordinate with each other. If we look at liquid container's own template, it just does yield this so that it can pass itself to its children. Now, yield this is a fairly promiscuous way to communicate with another component. It's appropriate when you have two tightly coupled components that are intended to be used together, particularly if that's kind of internal API to the system you're writing. There are more focused ways you can yield just the things you want the child components to be able to do if really what you're writing is a reusable library you expect other people to be using. Some of that gets easier in Ember 2.0 thanks to things like the fact that actions are now just going to be values you can pass around. They're just functions. They're no longer a special protocol for them. So in our case here, we are passing that container in as the notify property to the next helper down, which is called liquid versions. Again, I'm going to drop off the kind of optional stuff to clarify what's going on here. So liquid versions takes a value, a container to notify, and it yields up value version. And then remember, this is the template for liquid if. This is how liquid if is implemented. And we can see down at the bottom, it really is just an if. And so it's going to look at the value version. So this is some version of the value we've been passing to our if. If it's true, we're going to yield. If it's not, we're going to yield our inverse. LF yield inverse here is black magic. This is me reaching into the internals of Ember because we don't have a good public API for that yet. I'm working on it. We want to just make yield take an option so that your components can have an else block, and you can yield to it if you want to. Conceptually, it's a pretty straightforward thing. So the point, and I didn't really explain liquid versions. That's the other kind of secret bit of secret sauce here. It's not doing anything that is private API. All it's doing is it's going to yield up from a list of versions of the values we've passed into this helper. So in a case of a liquid if, it's the predicate we're testing. Each version of them, we're going to yield up if it should render, put in a liquid child with that value, and yield it up out to the next layer back. And so that's where the value version is going to come from. So the critical thing to think about here is that this yielding of a value version is not going to happen just once. Right? On the initial render, it's going to happen just once. But when somebody changes the state of that variable, you're going to get a new version. And the liquid versions components implementation is observing that value and popping it onto that list of versions. So now the list gets longer, and now we're going to yield twice. And this if block is going to run twice. It's all going to be in the DOM in parallel. And that's why you have new element and old element in the DOM together. Right? So I show this to kind of highlight that this is the kind of composition you could do with components in your own applications. And I've worked to try to make the vast bulk of what this library is actually doing inside is not anything that is deep black magic inside of Ember internals. I still depend on Ember internals in a few places. I'm working to make those public API. I literally have a file called Ember internals that tries to condense those all, and the rest is intended to be public API. So that these templates themselves actually define the behavior of the library pretty well, and they're just the same kind of templates you can write in your application. So so I highlight that as a bunch of ideas around patterns for composing components, because that's what it's all about. Using templates, or the more logic you can push down into templates, the better off I think you will be. Templates have been an amazingly stable piece of Ember's kind of core API surface for a very long time already, and they've really shown their worth because they're very declarative. We've been able to evolve with them over time, change their underlying implementation without changing their semantics, and that's pretty powerful. So I will now open up to questions, because that's the end of what I had planned.
To the mic if you have any questions.
Thanks, Ed. Can you talk a little bit how about this works for like a responsive app, like for a mobile app versus a web app?
Sure.
Is there any way to target things based on devices?
Excellent, yes. So that's actually an open issue on the repo, and one of the ones I want to nail for the 1.0 API stabilization. I would like to add a way so that in your transition map, you can actually use basically media queries and say, here's a rule that only applies, or here's a constraint in a rule that says, if device screen size, et cetera, is beyond a certain level, use this rule. So yes, we want that. We don't have that. I would like a PR. Work on it. Yeah. And actually, it's not too hard to do.
Could you just use one of your matchers, arbitrary call that?
Yeah, you absolutely could. That's true. You could definitely do that now. Yeah, you could absolutely do that. You could say, in fact, if you're going to do something absurd like that where you don't even care about the arguments, you can use whichever matcher you want. You know, from route, navigator user agent equals, So yes, you could do that now. We want to give it a nice way to do that. But yeah, so that's a good question. And that's on the list of things we want to nail down before we kind of solidify a 1.0 API come June. And there's actually an open issue for that with some discussion around how we're going to solve it. So you can check it out. Otherwise, performance is definitely always a key thing on mobile devices. They perform differently than desktops. People can check out Velocity, the library that we're using underneath to power most of the built-in animations, is sensitive to the differences between mobile and desktop. It actually tries to optimize, and it will do different things based on the context of the environment. An example of that is that on mobile, you basically almost always win by using GPU-accelerated capabilities when you can. On desktop, sometimes you actually don't. Sometimes you actually get a better performance by not using GPU acceleration if the amount of bits you're going to have to try to push into the GPU and off the GPU is so big that it's not even worth bothering. And so Velocity actually handles a bunch of that for you and does a pretty decent job of it. You do want to be aware of choosing the right properties to animate that are not going to be triggering gigantic reflows in your application and things like that. So it's always better to use transform property versus top and left when you can, as an example. Our opacity is very safe. It doesn't cause reflow of the rest of the document. We could do a whole new talk on performance optimization. But yeah.
Yeah, I was going to ask, do you find this impacts your tests much at all? And is there maybe a global way to turn it off, or is that not something you'd recommend?
That's a good question. So the library registers its own test waiters with Ember. That's a capability built into Ember's acceptance testing already. So when, you know, in the previous talk we saw from Mike, all those and then statements, right? And then is waiting for everything in Ember to settle down for you, so that if there's route transitions happening and the router knows they're waiting still, it'll wait. If there are test promises not resolved, it's going to wait for them to resolve, etc. Liquid Fire registers its own waiters that Ember is aware of, so that if there are transitions running, it will know about them. And so the and thens should still work. So you shouldn't have to change those integration tests. Now, things like a test of a component that is going to include some of these helpers, part of what motivated what I showed in the beginning, a new, better way of doing integration testing, is that if you're trying to unit test components, you have this, well, you're trying to pretend you're unit testing components because you think you're isolating, but then you have this giant list of dependencies. That list of dependencies for Liquid Fire is actually kind of deep, because as you saw in the templates, if you use a Liquid if, it's going to depend on a whole bunch of other things under the hood. It's got a Liquid container, and that's got its template, and it's got a Liquid versions, and that's got its template. And so that's all stuff that if you wanted to write a unit test for a component that calls Liquid if, is a pain in the butt. And so that's why I would recommend looking at the way the tests are done in LiquidFire itself, and hopefully soon just using the newer default way of doing test for an integration test for a component, where you can just drop it in the template, use it, and all the dependencies are taken care of for you. So basically, it does occasionally impact tests, but the vast majority of the cases should just work. You can write, you know, I often find myself writing in my actual transition rules, having the durations be not literal numbers that are just there, but calculated so that at the top of the file, I can have an if I'm testing, drop all their durations down so that it all runs much faster. That's nice to do. Velocity itself has an option to mock out all of the animations if you want them to basically all default to zero duration as well, and you can do that. So there are still corner cases where it will affect you if you're, you know, in particular, sometimes you really want to know that, like, what is the state of things in the middle of an animation? Like, is my animation actually running correctly? And so writing that kind of test is a little different, because you don't want to wait. You just want to wait a little while. So Liquid Fire's own test suite is a pretty good example of doing those kinds of things if you're interested. Yeah.
How well does it support SVG, and how deep is that support?
Oh, that's a good question. So we could actually support SVG really well. There's kind of one little feature I need and just haven't done, which is I showed that we introduced this markup, and today you don't have great control over the tag names of that markup. But we should be able to just give you an option to make those, say, G tags instead of div tags. And now you'd be able to do SVG directly, and it should just work. It's basically just has been waiting as a priority, but it's basically trivially easy to do if we just pay a little attention to that. And so if somebody wants that, definitely I'd be happy to kind of support you in adding that feature if that's something you want to work on.
Hey.
Hey.
So you said that it waits on transitions during testing to like resolve. What happens if a transition, or specifically a route transition, is like aborted and retried or something like
right.
that?
Right. So there's a subtle problem in the language there, because I'm overloading the term transition. What I was referring to is the animation, the animated transition. So your to left or your to up or your custom one. It waits for those. And Ember also waits by default for router transitions as well. So and aborting counts as being done. So in a test, if it aborts, it's done. It'll move on. Well, no, because the animation, by the time the animation's running, the router thinks it's done. Right? And that's actually kind of important, because that's how we have the new content ready to go and ready to animate, is that the router kind of did its thing. It filtered down to the view layer. It actually hit our helper, if that's liquid if or liquid outload or whatever. It actually rendered, is available, and now we can finally animate it. So by the time the animations are happening, the router thinks you're done. So if the router aborted, the animation would never have begun, unless you had a loading state, right? Ember has loading substates. From Liquid Fire's perspective, those are just regular route transitions. So you can write a rule that says, you know, from route contact suggestions to loading, do this thing. Then from loading to profile, do this other thing. Maybe don't animate at all. And so you should be able to write fairly rich rules that take into account loading states where you want to. So that would be a case where if there was an interruption, you would suddenly now transition from loading to error or something like that. And so they're fairly separate concerns. You know, the animation transitions themselves can also be interrupted by each other, in the sense that you know, if you have, say, a view sliding over, and the user clicks back, now you've got a new state coming in, and you can actually write them to try to handle interruption gracefully. We can do a lot more work there. That's an area I'm excited on, kind of future work as an area, making it easier to do very dynamic transitions like sliding on mobile devices, where you want to be able to like slide over with your thumb and peek at the next view over and then slide back, right? We're working on that stuff. We have good ideas of how we can implement that and try to hone it up and optimize it. Yeah.
All right.
Did I give you
All right, let's give a round of applause for Edward. Thank you.